Welcome to what is our third national discussion day. The last two have been informative, interesting. We're a sounding Deacon to say exciting. But today, hopefully, what we're going to do is get a lot of information, a lot of discussion going about projects that have now moved on since the last time that we did this.
We are actually interested in change. That's what the project is about, and therefore part of that is investing in community capacity and learning in order that we can actually make some change. And I suppose part of the advantage of both listening to Bill there and having this day is we're looking at to what extent can action communities and schools and all of the areas where we fund it actually make that change possible, and what are the issues that are both obstacles but also where we're making some progress. It is thinking about what have we learned, how would that contribute, and in terms of the bigger impact that we might want to make beyond projects, what would have to happen, and what would we say to the Scottish Government, for example, and all the other stakeholders about what would have to happen to ensure that that change is both reinforced and underpinned, but also given some momentum into the future.
I thought today was exhilarating, brilliantly thought-provoking, very exhausting as well, and some really serious discussion just about the different forms that sectarianism can take and the different challenges and the different potentials in tackling it.
I'm enjoying it. I enjoy taking part in discussions about sectarianism, and it's good to hear from other organisations who are doing the same sort of work across the country.
I found it very interesting. I was here as an observer, so I was here to listen. And I've been listening a lot, and I've learned a lot.
I think you must have these kind of discussion days because you don't get that rich diversity of different, you know, of the different projects and different experiences. And I think you always learn from those kind of experiences. So I think it's crucial to have them.
If I take my own example, being Edinburgh based, the projects are few and far between. So the chance to come and actually talk to other groups and organisations, it's a big plus for me because, you know, I'm working solo as well on my project. So the chances to actually engage with other professionals.
I think it's absolutely crucial that those involved in tackling sectarianism come together as equals to kind of discuss what's going well, what's not going well, the challenges in actually getting people to feel confident to discuss it. If we don't talk to each other, then we don't actually have a connected agenda to tackle it. And absolutely what we need is a connected agenda, because this is something that we can now open the box in Scotland with some confidence, look at whatever's inside it for communities and individuals and deal with it.
I think the key points that certainly come out is about keeping this going in some forum. That can't just be forgotten about because 31st of March end of funding. It's that it has to be kept going, and if anything, the network has to keep going and people have to keep meeting.
I think the key point is about momentum, is about looking at the good work that we've done over the past couple of years. I don't mean the advisory group, I mean the actual funded project, some of the excellent work, and thinking about how we sustain that in the medium to longer term. This is not an issue that we're going to solve overnight or within a few years. This is going to be a fairly long journey, but a doable journey, and therefore we need to be able to look forward to the next 10, 15, 20 years on how to best handle it with the best use of public money.
Almost everybody reported that this was a conversation that was very difficult to get started. People felt nervous. They were in denial, maybe a wee bit suspicious of why it was that organisations wanted to talk about sectarianism. A lot of gatekeeping going on by professionals who didn't really want to allow these conversations to take place. Difficulties around the gap between people's understanding and experience and the definition of sectarianism that was on offer. People finding it very difficult to talk about sectarianism, having negative perceptions about some of the organisations. A big problem was that in Scotland we don't know our own history, and therefore we were unable to locate in a common space, and unable to understand how the past was impacting on our present.
There were some superb examples of really direct, courageous engagement with people in local communities, finding sectarian attitudes in unexpected places, but being able to engage with that and to make a difference.
Creativity was mentioned several times, the really creative ways in which people seem to address some of the obstacles that they encountered. Using art, using drama, storytelling, doing videos, cinema, and getting people into the conversations by different routes, but quite often very creative routes.
Sectarianism opens up cans of worms across a whole lot of other issues, but it is also one of the worms in other people's cans. It comes, and we have to have a way to capture it at both ends. And it doesn't hardly exist outside, it's in that kind of complex relationship. Sustained ownership at community level, that actually real sustainability means is championed by ordinary people in ordinary places. We need to focus on where that is. Sustained heart in this work, as somebody said, which meant that the emotional life of it was taken seriously, and also tools. The real need to create tools, and some of the big things that we've learned here is about tools and resources and legacy. And one of the big questions we have at the end of a 3-year cycle is, if we now have all these tools, where do they go? Who's going to use them? Who's taking responsibility for the legacy of that? And that's a real question.